get nasty. Yes. Meme machine. I'm a motherfucking meme machine. Meme machine. Without memes, I will die. Give me the memes. I need the memes. I smell the memes. I need all the memes to survive. I need the memes. I breathe the memes. I smell the memes. I need all the memes to survive. They call me the meme machine. I catch the memes, I spread the memes, I eat the memes, I shit the memes. Without memes, I will die.
Guys, I don't know if you knew that, but Brunson wrote that song. He is the meme machine. And we are Tavern Talk, THL's first and no longer only official recap show. We are here week 5-6. And we got.
I don't know if you knew that, but Brunson wrote.
Whoa! I'm echoing back in here somewhere. That was scary. I heard my own voice for a second there, guys. I apologize if you hear me twice.
Pizza's in here too early.
Oh baby! Everything's going wrong. Panic basket!
Whoa! Pizza, I'm removing you. Go to Overwatch. That was scary.
It's all crashing into a fiery oblivion. All right, we are going to get that gentleman back in here shortly. Mr. Cassidy's enjoying home life in 2G service. So we have with us tonight, we got Mr. Nate filling in for him. We're going to hear back from Pizza in a little bit when we bring him into Discord. Our house rules are as they've been for the past 2 weeks. We're going to see how it feels. The beer's tasting delicious tonight, so I'm going to make sure we're enforcing these rules. When we go over our top 10, or our PPR, we're going to take 10 drinks for all 10 players. When any of the feels gets thrown out there, good, bad, or otherwise, power rankings, power hour. You guys know how it goes. Every minute you're drinking. And then the Wicked Wednesday waterfall. Pretty much that just means make sure your damn drink's done by the time Wicked Wednesday recap's done. All right. So
I don't have enough drinks for this.
Yeah, I have a feeling halfway through the show tonight I'm going to need to go get more.
Yeah, I'm going to have to do a beer run.
To my left, your right, as always, holding it down for the corporate shills of the world, is the one and only bearded beauty, Mr. Slimch. How are you, sir?
I am doing well. How are you, Mr. Jack Sox? This is my shill. My shill.
I'm a Power Ranger tonight, so.
Get up close. You can read my shill company.
So corporate.
Where I'm a socio-normative one.
Does that mean we're now sponsored by them?
No.
Damn it.
I'll ask them, though.
Anchoring us down the corner, holding it down for Mr. Cassidy, is THL personality, Mr. Nade, looking like a dapper gentleman. How you doing down there, sir?
Doing well. Thanks for having me.
Oh, dude. It's a blast to have you on.
I'm excited, man.
All right. So let's get into this. We had – I don't know what the hell we have to do to get the – I mean, actually, in the end, the Wicked Wednesday numbers weren't too bad. But I'm a little greedy. We had a couple weeks there where it was like 27, 25. We're up there approaching like high 20s, possibly 30.
When the money was in the mix.
And I want to get back there. I want to get back to that point. So, guys, next week, it's my first week of summer vacation. Make a drunken Jack Sox happy. And let's get the Wicked Wednesday back up to those near 30 numbers. But, Slimch, you're going to have to help me because I'm burping up my beer over here. I know, it's gross. Ew. What went down Wicked Wednesday this week?
I think you well remember that you quit in a fit of rage after you had lost.
Dan's game!
I don't know. I didn't plan it myself. I said that I was going to cast finals. Then I went back to my Facebook post and I edited it to be a CX, which is the new meta. So, yeah, I was hanging out in Discord with a lot of the people who were playing. And Hector Howell, who is new to the community, has been making himself known. I think this might be the second Wicked Wednesday that he's won. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. He won his first endeavor. He's from my fireside and a new SPL captain. If you haven't found a place within the SPL now, Mr. Hector Howell's got a team going. You can jump on it.
Yeah, can SPL jump in any time in the season?
One might be dropping out, so he might be displacing or something. Yeah, he had a really impressive run. In fact, yeah, he took out MB Parker, Mange, Smoked Salmon, and Dunamis, who are, I don't know, these are all like 400 plus, and then some PR guys in the league, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Apparently a Hector lost to the aggro priest that Parker brought. He was memeing it up the other night.
The spiciest of memes is the priest meme. That Wicked Wednesday was definitely a very emotional day for me. Mange had to talk me into reinstalling Hearthstone in order to play Wicked Wednesday. And then I immediately wish I hadn't. I'm sorry, Donnie. I'm a dick. I'm just straight up. I'm a dick. I don't know if you got my message, but look for it. It's out there somewhere. I sent you a love note. So that was Wicked Wednesday. Let's make sure that next week, I want Slinch to stream those finals. Let's get those numbers up. Let's get those numbers going. Also starting next week, and I'm super excited about this. It's an idea that's been in the works for a little while, and it's one of the many reasons we want to have Mr. Nade here with us tonight. Is June 20th, Monday night, at what time, Nade?
8 Eastern.
8 Eastern. THL's second official recap show, As the Salt Settles, makes its premiere. Nate, tell us more about it, man.
Yeah, sure. So I believe this was an idea that was of your inception. I think you brought it up to Salt a while back, maybe back in January. Jem and I was on our team last season, so when she was in team practices with us, Salt was on the couch, and we just naturally started building a relationship. He was telling me about this idea, and it sounded good. But I think we kind of just brushed it away for a while because we were so caught up in the season two. So then hit him up like maybe a month ago and said, let's see if we could find a way to make this work. Because really, we saw that you guys were going for like 2 hours, 2.5 hours, 3 hour show every now and then. And so the first thought was if there's anything that we could do to take, you know, some of the stuff off your plate so that you could spend more time focusing on the stuff that you guys are already talking about. So that's kind of what we're doing with the Reek Review, talking about stream matches. And then another thing was just allowing kind of a stage for other people in the community to be heard. So that's what we're doing with the Winner Circle. You know, it's allowed people who are just kicking ass in THL to come on and you know, talk about their successes and their victories. League standings was a segment that we thought of to kind of be the opposite perspective of power rankings. So it's just going to be numbers where everybody is, who's looking to make their way into the playoffs, hunting for wild cards, etc. We're going to do the THL Top Dogs, which is just, again, going to be by numbers, the top five players, you know, the top five records in each seed. And then we'll be giving out some different conversations about where we think they're going to go and how they're going to perform and kind of argue about that a little bit because we have very different viewpoints on where players are shaking out and stuff like that. And that's going to kind of be the opposite of who we now know is Jerry Damage, props for coming out, for what he does with the player power ranking. So it's kind of just like different types of segments that are going to complement other types of content that's out there already. And what else are we going to do? We're going to highlight SPL because right now they really don't have a spotlight. But I know, especially with, you know, following them, just because I thought this was such a cool idea, that there's a lot of guys working hard down there. So, you know, we want to have an opportunity for them, you know, to have their spotlight. We'll talk about them. We'll invite a team each week. They can interview, tell us about their experience with SPL, but also give you guys SPL Listen Up. You know, if you're doing good and you want to come on and talk about how you want to join THL next season, you know, you can have a whole audience where of captains or other players who might be looking to you now that you have experience in the league that you can kind of come in next season. So that's what we're doing. We hope you guys like it. We hope you guys watch. I hope Brunson's recruiting an army of people are going to show up and just bash our chat so you can meet us up over there. And, yeah, that's what we're doing.
I'm pumped about it. Man, one of the things I said when I first heard this is, you know, Tavern Talk's great, and I have an awesome time talking with Slim and Cassidy and the guests we get on, and our fourth host, Mange. But I've never got to experience, like, the Tavern Talk experience without the stress. And I can't wait to kick back on Mondays and just
same
be a member of an audience and just take it in. And I think it's interesting that the segments are going to be different. You know, I feel like there's going to be enough of a different flavor that those who tune in on Monday and Thursday aren't going to feel like they're getting bashed with the same repeated information. I'd love the opportunity to give different types of folks a place to have a voice in a spotlight. So As the Salt Settles, going to make its premiere Monday night, 8 p.m. Eastern. And if we got that wrong, it'll be spammed in the Facebook group, as most information in this group typically does get put out there. All right. So, sweet. Let's get into power rankings. Am I reading that correctly? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, go ahead, Slim. My voice.
No, you had the notes.
Yeah, so I want to kick this thing off with a question that this is not – don't think what I'm saying is a positive or a negative. It's just kind of a point that I found to be interesting. And I bring this up every week with – the cool thing about the power player rankings or the player power rank PPR is that now I could go to Jerry and be like, hey, Jerry, what the hell? With – power rankings, I'm still trying to figure things out as to how it's all done. And the point that I found to be interesting here, I'd love your guys' input on, is Team Supreme and Team Rank 5 square off in the Clash of the Titans. And Team Rank 5 wins, and Supreme loses. So Team Rank 5 finally gets to prove that they're not this fraudulent team that Cassie has been up here telling you they are. They're legit. Yeah,
they're good, man.
But at the same time, Supreme drops all the way to 4 for losing to the best team in the league according to the power rankings. And I understand if you lose, there has to be consequences. But if you lose to the only team that's better than you, should that have been that big of a fall?
Yeah, I don't agree with it, because the idea of power rankings is not just your score, but your power, right? So, like, if you lose to the most powerful team or one of the best, I don't think it should adjust that much, but that's just
plus me. Oh, so Harry Generals are officially above Supreme? No, Supreme's still number one.
They're still on top of the blue, yeah.
Oh, wait, or is that with data from this week? That's with data from this week, because it's automatically updating itself. Yeah, I thought Harry Generals were the first. It's got that weird placement going on right now. But yeah, I don't know if they should have fallen as much as they did, although I think they as much got pushed down by their loss and also displaced by Zenergy, who had a really huge week, which maybe they got boosted up too much. We don't really know. They have the most points in the league right now, though. So
it's hard to really... And that was another question I had, was did Zenergy make too much of a jump? Because I guess, as Cassie usually does, is the guy that points this out, is who would you put in their place, or could you justify them being above X, Y, and Z? And I guess in my heart, there's really only one team I could make a valid argument for them being above in the Harry Generals. But was Zenergy's jump too big? And was Supreme's jump too far, or fall too great? And Slim, I just heard that you said the Zenergy jump kind of feels good. Did I hear that correctly?
They do have the number one amount of points in the league, although, I mean, they got a huge, huge win. There's been a lot of those this season. They jumped more early on. But now, like, where was the Dream Team? Dream Team was 7 last week, and they demolished them. So maybe they should have jumped quite a bit. Yeah. I think it's acceptable.
Nate, what do you think? Was Supreme's fall too great? Was Zenergy's rise too much?
I think Supreme fell too much. Minus 2 after that 1 week. You know, like I said before, you know, I would maybe give them minus 1, right? I don't know. Zenergy up 4. Yeah, if I were doing this, I would put them up 3 or 4 based on what happened, but, you know, everybody's going to do this differently. But
yeah,
I don't think there's anything that's drastically out of place.
Ooh, Jedi just made a great point in chat that despite whatever the points may currently say, they lost to the Harry Generals, and the Harry Generals beat Supremes 1 and 2 seed. So, valid point, Jedi. Touche, and well played. The one thing I would like to absolutely give a nod on to THLAP here is usually as I read these rankings, I look for points of interest such as Supremes falls, and then I do, did this team jump too high or did this team fall too low? And outside of this little interesting dynamic with Supreme, which the more we're talking about seems to be more and more justified, I don't really think anybody fell too low. And as a matter of fact, I really think in those rankings that are kind of hard, the 9 through 20, things are kind of looking exactly how I would expect them to look. And I think the top 8 is becoming a little more clear. You got those fringe teams like the Euro Noob Central and the superheroes that have these sparks and then kind of get snuffed a little bit.
The problem with us is we've been ranked too high all season. We don't do well off of that. We feed off of being the underdogs. Knock us down more. Come on.
That Netherstorm loss. By the way, Netherstorm only went up one spot. Maybe they should have gone up more. They're quietly hanging out in third over in blue standings.
Then I think that's kind of the blessing and curse of being in blue with the Harry
Boys. 2 points behind.
Yeah, with the Harry Boys and Supreme over there doing a whole bunch of shouting, it's kind of hard to be that third team heard. And, Nate, we've seen what Noob Central will do if you let them hang around the last 2 weeks of the season, especially if I tell you that you have no shot of making the playoffs.
Right. Please tell me that, please.
No shot.
A point coming from the chat that I want to bring up from Cassie, who thanks, Cassie, for tuning in. I know you weren't able to make it otherwise tonight. I don't think Zergy has enough gas up top to compete with the top dogs. Fair or unfair?
I don't know. I haven't been paying close enough attention Red Marsh and Boom. Well, Boom Boom Hall seems to be doing well. I haven't been paying close enough attention to Red Marsh, though. But I think Boom Boom Hall, I mean, had experience as a 1 seed before and did well then.
So what about
2 seed now then?
What about, I don't want to make this sound wrong, but Katoda for a long time was one of the great titans and godlike players. Do you think this is a case of him still trying to figure out the meta, or is this just, you know, a rough season, which happens?
Dude, my opinion, it's a new game, man. Like, you know, you could say that about Katoda. You look at last season with Cutthroat being an all-star at, like, 5-1 in the regular season. He's still looking for, like, to score more than 2 points in 1 week. Not to bash on my own teammate. I love you, brother. But it's a new game that we're playing. Mm. You know, and I don't know much about Katoda or his history or his style of decks that he likes to play or that sort of thing. But I think we're seeing it a lot more this season than we've seen in a while.
Katoda's a really smart player. He, like, with what he prepared for the week that we played this season, he utterly destroyed me. I've never run into anyone in THL who has planned so well for me and beaten me so convincingly. So I don't know.
He's still on his game.
I'm kind of more about Katoda than ever this season. And he taught me a good lesson, which I've tried to spread to everyone. Don't bring that Uther guy or Gyadrin. Whatever. You will get punished.
Two more positive shout-outs coming from our boy Cassidy in chat. He does think that Roy is the real deal. A Roy, however you pronounce it properly. And I don't think anybody could disagree with that. And he also gives a shout-out to the 5 seed down there in Supreme, who we all had question marks about the 4 and 5 in Supreme. And Sneaky has turned out to be the real deal. So, points coming from Cassie, even though he is not in his typical anchor chair, he's still giving us that content and that insight we appreciate. You know, just wondering, Slim, would now be a good time, before we get into Power Player rankings, to bring in our buddy Pizza?
Is Pizza still one of them? He is. He's number four.
Yeah.
I mean, let's talk. Let me warn the guy.
Do you want to give him a warning and we talk about the player rankings? Well,
sure.
All right. So tell him that as soon as we're done with this segment, we'll grab him. Power player rankings are in their second week. As we said earlier on, Jerry has come out as the author of the segment. If you are in the Facebook thread, he made it known. And also, awesome news from Nate in our pre-production meeting. They are talking about a tentative. They're still working out the details of when it's going to be. Not this Monday show, but quite possibly 2 Mondays from now. Jerry being on there to talk a little bit more about his formula and how he goes about doing the PPR. So that's, I'm excited to hear that. He also gave a little excerpt blurb thing at the top of this week's PPR to let you guys know the formula that was used and what it's akin to. I learned a lot from it, and there's a couple suggestions I know people made of why did you or didn't you include this piece or that piece. So hopefully we'll hear more about that in 2 weeks on As the Salt Settles. But
seventh.
The top 10, some familiar names on there, and then the absence of some pretty big names, a couple that really shocking to see them fall completely off the list with one loss. But Racy moves his way from number 2 into number 1. Is anybody really shocked by this?
No.
Wouldn't be surprised if he's the season 3 MVP.
MVP? Well, I mean, starting off in the 3 spot, you know, any week he was there, that's just kind of like a layup.
In bulk Bible thumping, but he's one of the notable ones who fell off this list.
Yeah, yeah. He should still be on that list.
Nate, you yourself find your way to number 2 in there.
This is arguable. Like, you know, I had the DQ win, and then I had a series with Arcane Fu where it was 2-1 at the point. We're in like turn 9, and then he disconnected, so it's like, you know, that secured a 3-1. So it's like I feel like there's 2 wins I didn't fully deserve, but you know, if he's going by points scored for your team, you know, that's that. I'm not gonna say that I belong here. I'd put Cran over me.
Well, you know, I would almost argue that Cran might be in the same boat. And I don't know if it was Slim Shoe or Cassie that was saying this last week. As Cran does come in at number 3, I'm not gonna blow Nate's head up here and make him feel all good about himself, because that's not what we do here on Tavern Talk. We're here to make you feel bad about yourself.
Yes, please.
Overrated.
Yeah, you're totally overrated.
I'll take it.
But Cran is, I don't think anybody would argue that he's a great player. But I think we can all be in agreement that for a long time, Cran has enjoyed being on a very strong team in a position, a seating, that makes it almost unfair for everybody he's going up against. 5-0 for him is a little different from most people at 5-0, because the caliber, or I don't want to say the caliber, I don't want to make people feel too bad about themselves, but he's a step up above most of the people he's playing. Not all.
You could argue the same for Racy, so maybe it's just a coincidence that all these guys are finding themselves
up.
Not a coincidence, rather.
Because you opened your mouth, now I'm going to ask you the question, all right?
Hey.
If Racy played this entire season as a 1 seed, do you still expect him to be on this top 10 list?
Yeah.
Why not?
You know, that's if Cran moved up to a 1 seed, would he still be on this top 10 list?
No. Well, with this record, or?
No, I'm just saying on the list. Because I'm going to say, because THL is THL, man. Racy is an awesome player. But we've watched the likes of Cheesy, Dear Jason, Loaded Lux, Hot Asian Girl. We've watched these people lose. We've watched, you know, people can lose even if they are the better player. Because as Mange likes to say, you know, Hearthstone's Hearthstone. Or whatever he says about the RNG that is Hearthstone, and any player could lose on any given day just because that's the nature of this game. But would they still remain on this top 10 list? Would they still have a good enough record and total overall points to still be on the list?
For Cran, I don't know. He might find himself up in one of those seats someday. I think he'd definitely be good as a 3 or probably decent as a 2 seed, but as a 1 seed, I would guess not, but I don't know how harshly I can judge Cran. I think the guy's only ever lost 2 matches in the past few seasons.
Do you have a different perspective on that, Nate, or are you kind of in the same boat?
You know, I don't think there's an argument in the opposite direction. I also don't know too much about him, so I really can't say much. But, yeah, sure, when you change a seed, like, it gets a lot tougher. Like, I was afraid to play against Twiz. Like, I'm sitting here at rank 16. I know he's, like, probably a multi-legend guy. It's like, but Hearthstone will be Hearthstone. You know, I drew okay. We never saw Reno from Twiz a lot of games. So it's like, it could work out in your favor, so.
Yeah, just for the kind of insight, he's a player who's flirted a couple times with the 400 PR. He's sitting at about 370 right now, somewhere around there. He's a player, though, that's flirted with the 400 level PR in the 4 seed. Product of his own success. He's earned that PR. You know, it's not like he came into the league as a 400 in the 4 seed. He's risen to that. But still, I feel like he is not a 4 seed player enjoying.
No.
It was much like when Mange was there. But let's move on. So we got Pizza, who's going to be with us in a minute. G-Nets, who suffered his first loss this week, but I don't think anybody would argue that he belongs to be on this list. Great overall scores. In his loss, he still won 2 games, so he earned the maximum amount of points you can in loss for his team. Lord Forehead, so pumped about that. Jumping off in there to to the 6th spot, another 5 seed up here, representing for 5 seeds everywhere.
Nice.
You know, but it's some names on there that I've played against and recognize. Taking down the captain, Rad Dreams, Hen Dog, who will throw a curveball and a slider at you at the same damn time. Dreaded, who's I don't know, he beat me, man, but that ain't saying much. And then the Grim Gamer himself. So Lord Forehead's got some names under his belt. Clark Kent, Verde, Cracksmith, and another 5 seed at Gemini. That's another Noob Central folk up there. So, interesting point that was brought up by Verde in the Facebook thread about this. And he said to kind of, we all know this, it was something to the paraphrasing here, but does the author of this list know that I don't even play Hearthstone anymore?
Do you even Hearthstone, bro?
I am sure there are better players or players of higher caliber. He's something to the effect of, like, I don't take this game seriously. I'm winning by either chance or whatever he was saying.
He's still a good player.
So this is something I hope we follow up on with Jerry and Nate. I'm kind of going to put this ball in your court for when you have them on there face-to-face. What degree does that play into it? Is there the intangible, the unmeasurable? Because he goes into all the data he enters. I want to know, does the work ethic, mentality, deck building, all the stuff you can't measure through data, is that taken into consideration or account at all?
Well, here's a better question. Can one person collect all that data on 100 people? Like, you know, does Jerry Damage know how you build decks? Does he know how Slimch prepares for the week? So I think the better question is, yeah, we all want to know that.
so then
I'm getting on this top 10 list.
Is it purely objective? And if that's the case, I am personally fine with objectivity. If a guy wins, you know, if there's 7 categories you could be the best at in a sport and you win 5 out of those 7 categories, how could you give it to somebody else? So if you score the most points, you have the best record, and you're on a team with one of the best records, like, I'm fine with that. But I do know there's a lot of folks that have a problem with the lack of measuring intangibles. I'm not one of them, but
sure.
I do think that there's something to be said for if Ray C right now were sitting at 3-2 instead of 5-0, I still think he's one of the top 10 players in our league. I would even go as far as to say in the top 3, even sitting at 3-2.
Right.
But he just lost 2 games. So it'll be interesting. I would like to hear more about that as I'm sitting there watching and drinking on Mondays. So if you could sneak that in there and however you feel comfortable at asking it, that'd be cool, man.
Yeah, and we'll let him do the talking.
I don't want to hear that much from Verde. He was he hit rank 4 last season. He's been playing some Hearthstone. But yeah. I don't know. That was funny to see.
Yeah, that was a good one. Is your boy ready to come on in?
Yeah.
All right. So, Nate and Slim, make sure you remember to mute yourself on Skype so we could get the Discord going.
All right. I'm dragging the pizza. Pizza!
Oh, there is pizza.
Hello?
Hey, what's up?
Hey, how's it going?
Dude, I'm super pumped to have you on.
Can do the same for the fine folks.
Yeah, I'm actually turning him down because he's blasting my ears right now.
Jack Sox?
Can you not hear me?
Jack Sox, we...
All right, I'm going to do a quick refresh. All right, so you guys get to spend some one-on-one time with Jack Sox. The best time there is. Awesome. This is why we moved away from Discord for our voice, for those who were wondering. So, Nate, if you did not hear my first welcome, thanks for being here, man. Super pumped to have you on tonight.
Pizza.
What did I say? Nate? Fucking Nate, thanks for being here, man. Oh, wow, shit, did you just get here? Who have I been talking to for 25 minutes? Pizza, thanks for being here, man. Super pumped to have you on. And now I'm going to let Slimsh do the talking.
Are you, though? Because I'm about to move Nate. I'm trying to help Nate out over here.
All right, so I will start it off, man. So we had a couple questions about your non-THL Hearthstone career, such as, you know, your top 100 finish last season. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
And also 4-day legend climb this season.
It's actually a 2-day legend climb. I took the first day off because I was just so tired, and I had to move.
Oh my god!
I recently moved, and then I just sort of like played through the couple days. So the numbers are a bit awkward there. But yes, I did on the third day.
It's intense.
That is crazy. How many top 100 finishes have you had?
This would be my second.
Nice.
Sweet. So rumor has it out there that you are attending DreamHack Montreal.
I am. I'm sponsored by Evo Gaming out of Flushing, New York, as of a couple days ago. So
that's pretty awesome. Have you attended things of this size before?
For other card games, I have. I used to play a lot of competitive Magic,
mm-hmm.
So I've gone all around the East Coast, and I went to Gen Con in 2011 for the Magic National Championships. So, like, I'm no stranger to like competitive events, but this is the first DreamHack I'm going to.
That's pretty cool. I also came from Magic into Hearthstone, so we have that same back. I wasn't competitive. I was just a memer.
When is DreamHack Montreal? So the folks at home know?
August 12th, I believe, the week that weekend. Or, yeah. Yeah, the weekend of August 12th. Wow.
So here's a question for you. If you get to some sort of crazy top 8 interviewing status on there, are you going to be wearing THL swag?
Well, I'm pretty committed to an Evo Gaming shirt right now, yeah.
So I ask again, are you going to be wearing THL swag?
Money.
I'll get like a sticker and I can put that on my laptop, since it's a bring your own device event, and then they can have that on camera.
Bam, there we go. That's all.
Stickers on the shirt, that'll be it.
Oh, pizza. People, I was just browsing over at chat, and also, it's very sad. Nade cannot hear anything. Really not sure. Yeah, he's typing in chat. Discord hates me, Bob with him. What'd you climb the legend with? I heard rumors were Zoo.
I climbed the bulk of it with Zoo. I'm pretty sure, like, entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Would you feel comfortable in sharing any more details on that Zoo deck? Because I am a Zoo player and I hate Hearthstone right now because I can't find I can't find a Zoo deck that will work for me. And I'm totally blaming it on the deck and not the pilot of the deck, because that's what good Hearthstone players do.
Yeah, I mean, I don't blame you at all for hating Zoo right now. It actually it's pretty tough because as opposed to like the majority of the time in early in the season, like everybody's on an aggro deck. So you're going to find like Face Hunter, Aggro Shaman, Zoo, and all those sorts of things. This time around, there was a lot of Warrior, and that made the climb kind of awkward to deal with. I was playing, as opposed to a lot of the double Doomguard versions, I played one Leroy and one Soulfire. So that kind of hedged the Control Warrior matchup a lot, because like from rank 1 to Legend, there were quite a few of them. And then, like, the game plan at that point just sort of became dodge the Warrior so that you can actually get through the last couple of games.
There's a lot of Warrior out there.
Yeah. So, I'm very happy to hear you say that because I was in a kind of a group effort, a co-op effort to build a Zoo deck that would work for me. And everybody kept trying to force double Doomguard in there on me. And it didn't feel good. I liked the Leroy option. I'm glad to hear that there's other people out there that also feel that way.
And I think that's the majority, to be honest.
Well,
wait, can you guys hear me?
We can hear you.
Oh, nice. It's working.
There we go.
Oh!
PogChamp, Nate's back.
Got him.
So, how has your experience been? This is something I always like to find out from higher-level players. How has your experience been in the THL? How do you find the caliber of your opponents and the community as a whole?
It's been fun. I came in at the one seed, so I sort of expected that my opponents would, like, at the very least, know what they were doing. While it hasn't been the best season for Boom Squad, like, I've tried to, like, make myself available to the other teammates. I already knew Dean Lyman, so, like, I didn't really feel like interacting with him, but Austin is really good. Brunson I've spoken to quite a bit. He seems pretty good. And Tiny Hippo was originally there, but I didn't get to see him at all, unfortunately. But, like... Yeah, I saw it as a good opportunity to, like, just, like, interact with other people, players. Like, I wasn't too competitive about it.
Yeah, so did you know, because I know that D. Lyman, Asna, and even last season, Chef Sasha, I know all those folks knew each other beforehand. Did you know these guys, like, were you part of that clique, or did you meet D. Lyman at these Hearthstone events that you guys go to in that area?
I actually met Dean Lyman on Ladder.
Oh, okay.
We just played, and like I found out because I was going to an Esports Hero event that he was also in New York. So,
right. I remember him saying that he pulled you off Ladder. Actually, Jack, before you, I have a kind of a follow-up question. So you've got a sponsor, but you don't have any teammates associated with that. Is that correct? It's kind of like a lone wolf contract thing.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. This place is relatively new, so there aren't any other players. But they just like they wanted exposure, and they saw how well I was doing, so they wanted to just help me out. Yep.
All right. So THL is kind of nice, in that fact.
Yep.
Cool.
So here's a daring question to ask, but once again. Gonna ask because you're one of the higher level players. If you could change one thing, and only one thing, about the THL, what would that one thing be that you change?
It's
more Brunsons.
More Brunsons would be pretty good. He's a pretty dank gamer. I guess I would. What would I do? I would. That's like the worst question you could have possibly asked. I wish
Jeez,
I.
Jeez, Jack sucks.
I know, right? Here I am asking what I think is the tough question. I'm actually just ruining everything.
That's a good thing that Vicarious actually brings up in chat. Something that I was concerned about, like, for a PR cap, like as I saw in when I was checking the stats for like other teams, there's a certain point where like if everybody starts winning.
Mm-hmm.
Their numbers just like go through the roof, and I thought that it was just sort of something you'd figured out, but I didn't know how you would allocate those numbers, so to speak. Like, what happens if there's just five super solid players? Like, is there ever a point where there's like a mercy rule that would have to be implemented?
Yeah, it's called the end of the season. The fact of the matter is this is, yes, season 3 of THL, but it's actually, what, season 7 or 8? We had
Alpha, Beta, and Kappa.
So it's season 6.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the thing about it is it's not a perfect system. I think we've tweaked about 3 or 4 times along the way, and we're actually still in the process of tweaking it. Because to your point, sometimes it feels a little ridiculous, either imbalanced to the point of a team has such crazy players that it feels unfair to their opponents, or you get stuck in the situation I was in this season where we had a player back out last minute and we didn't have enough space to pick up a true player within the realm of what we needed. So, you know, you have a team that's sitting at 1900 versus a team that's sitting at 1200, and it feels bad, man. But that's definitely something we were taking a look at and trying to figure out. And we take input all the time. So if you ever do have a good suggestion to that, do feel free to pass it along, because we take it all into consideration, man.
Definitely.
So, all right, I got a couple questions. That one's my personal question. Actually, it's not.
Last question.
It's not. All right, so it's a statement followed by a question. Those were some sick ice cream sandwiches you were making last night.
They were delicious.
I was going to ask, were they as good as they looked?
The nuts that we used to insert into the ice cream, those also had chocolate in them. So like every time I bit in, like it was just.
I gotta watch this show, man.
Like an explosion.
It's dude, I set it up so that I got Wiki Wednesday going on, and now watching Chef Sasha over here and Wiki Wednesday over there. It's pretty great. And the other question, this is what the folks at home really want to know.
They do.
Because this was my first reaction to seeing you on Chef Sasha was, what kind of product do you use in that luscious hair?
I don't really. Do you want me to go like read the bottle?
Don't tell them your secrets, man.
Dude, like,
I'm gonna get to where you are, and I need a product to guide me.
So
I just use whatever my mom buys, like.
Dude, is this does it say shampoo on? Good, I'm good to go. I hear Slim say yesterday, as we're all in Discord playing Wiki Wednesday, "Oh, pizza's on Chef Sasha," and I was like, "What? Wait." So I usually just listen to it, but now I've got it, like, visually up there, and the first reaction in my head was, "That fucking hair is awesome."
Thank you.
So I think much like Samson, you're straight, not Josh Samson. He has no strength. But the mythical being that is Samson, I said mythical, get over it. I think your strength is in your hair, man. It's in your hair. Well, Mr. Slimsh, do you have any further questions for Mr. Pizza this evening?
No. I just really wanted to have Pizza on to congratulate about all your success with the top 100 climb, with the early climb this, and also attending DreamHack Montreal. That's sweet. LAN should be a lot of fun. I don't know if you've ever been to a LAN.
I've been to a couple.
All right, cool.
Not nothing of the size.
Oh, yeah, the esports arena one's probably in New York, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so just we're really glad to have you here. Wanted to celebrate that.
Nate, you sound like you had something to...
Oh, yeah, before I was figuring out my audio, did we ask Pizza how he came up with the name Pizza?
No, we did not.
That's all I want to know.
Like, my name, my real name is Andrew Dinosaur, and when I played on Magic Online, I was Andrew Dinosaur, and that's too long for Battle.net. So like, I was like, I had my beta key, I was trying to log in the Battle.net, and I couldn't think of a good name, and I was literally eating a slice of pizza.
There you go.
That's the story.
Pizza's perfect. You have my favorite name in THL.
Thank you.
Congrats to you and all of the success that you've been having, man.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Pizza, thank you so much, man, for making the time to be here. I know we had a little mix-up last week. I was super pumped to hear we could get you this week. I wish you continued success, not just in THL, but in Hearthstone in general. And let us know, man. Keep us updated on how the sponsorship goes and if you're streaming or if you're at tournaments, because we have viewing parties, man. We all sit there and cheer on our guys. So keep us updated as to what's going on in your career, man, so we can support you along the way.
I will certainly do that. Thanks a lot, guys.
All right, buddy.
Take it easy, man.
Thanks, pizza.
Good night.
All right, Team Tavern Talk, back to Skippy. I got to get the volume back over here. Super professional production over here. Do I got you guys? I got Slinch back. I got Nade back. Wow, man, what a cool dude.
Jack Sox.
Jack Sox, come and play.
Did I mute myself? I muted myself. I'm sitting here talking.
Oh, there we go.
I'm sitting here talking, and I asked you guys to unmute yourself, and then I don't unmute me.
Yeah.
I was just saying, what a cool dude, man. So happy we got him on.
Yeah, pizza's awesome.
Gemini says we had pizza for dinner.
OPOP.
There you go.
All right.
She was actually talking about the food, but I'm going to pretend that she was making, you know, an inappropriate reference. All right, so week that was. Let's dive into this because we got to do things. So, Slim, I got to give you guys a little heads up. Slim did something very fucking smart tonight in our document. It actually went back and pulled up the matches we talked about in the week that last week. Like, this most common sense fucking thing ever. But before we get into that, let's talk about the classes. Fasama breaks it out again for us, and I'm not too surprised about it, but Warrior takes the top spot again. And we're seeing a large early on this season, and you guys tell me how this was for you, because I know we're all at different ranks on ladder. Early on this season, I was seeing almost exclusively Tempo Warrior. Now I feel like all I see is Control and Cthune. Are you guys seeing that same trend?
Oh, I'm seeing more Dragon. More than anything. And then I see Tempo as well. But I also don't play that much. And I'm sitting at rank 16. So Slim.
There's just everything on the ladder. And I go to something that we're going to shout out later to see what the trends are. And apparently, the Cthune Warrior, like, it was not so much the case. But it's really taken over as one of the big ones. And Control Warrior is not too far behind it. So it seems like, for some reason or other, people are lending themselves to the slowest versions now. And also on the Hush Hush OP rise is Dragon Warrior variants. And there's a lot of them. There's some more control-focused ones, and there are some more tempo-oriented ones. And I'd argue that some of the tempo-oriented Dragon Warriors are better than, like, non-Dragon Tempo Warriors. It's really, really strong.
Somebody's got to show me the way.
Warrior's sweet. Talk to Parker, Mange, Cassidy. They've all been playing it. Mange and Parker hit Legend with it this season. So.
Yeah, so Team Rank 5, get at me.
Get at me.
Coach me through it. All right, so 83, 82, 81. All right, that's all I'm saying. I know we all have the graphics. Don't look at them. Don't cheat. Who do you think is the 82? 83 was Warrior. Who's 82?
Well, I'm looking right at the graph.
Damn it. Nate, are you looking at it too?
I've been all over them.
I mean, I kind of knew. I probably could have told you already because I look at this thing probably every
82%
day.
82% of what THL brought, that's probably Rogue or Priest, right?
confirmed. Yes.
Confirmed. Okay, good.
Yeah, Warlock, of course. I think the vast majority of them are playing Zoo. We've come to learn this now. It's basically what's on ladder. But I would not discredit the strength of Reno Warlock in the right situations. The other week, you guys didn't get to see it on Team Rank Friday, but I was playing against Hot Asian Girls Freeze Mage, and Eater of Secrets got himself an Ice Block and an Ice Barrier. It was pretty
heard
sick.
About it. That's impressive. That's the new tech.
So don't, like, if the opportunity presents itself for Reno Warlock to, you know, tech accordingly to whatever's in front that is really polarizing, I would do it.
I actually almost put Eater of Secrets in my Zoo, but I heard from Stiller the day before my match that Spam's a lot played Reno Mage, and I knew that he would only have one Ice Block, probably no Ice Barrier, so I just assumed that Twiz would do the same thing, which it turned out that he did, so I put a second Soulfire there instead and got me lethal, so I'm happy.
Got him.
So, even though we have Warlock and Warrior being brought in high amounts, proportionately, Shaman still remains the highest banned. I'm not too surprised by that, but the more I play the Shaman, the less I become intimidated by it. Do you guys think it's worth the ban?
It can snowball out of control, man.
I think mid-range shaman, especially, you can say the same about aggro shaman. It's kind of like the druid these days, kind of like the secret paladin. I don't know. I think it's just safe to ban because it doesn't really have many bad matchups. It's not a very polarizing deck. It's just overall OP. They've got 4-mana 7/7s. They've got, at times, 0-mana 5/5s with taunt. Sometimes they're 2-mana. Oh, God. Oh, what a shame. It's only 2-mana 5/5 with taunt. It's just... The power level is just sick with Shaman. You can take it in so many different directions. Not nice people.
Not nice people, indeed. So let's see how those Shamans did this week, as many people attempted to bring them. I skipped past the week that we're talking about. So we touched on this a little bit earlier, as the Dream Team, who was sitting in second in red, took on Zenergy, sitting second in green. And Zenergy comes out with a pretty decisive victory. I've been high on the Dream Team all season long, but are we starting to see that maybe 20-3 is kind of a big statement? Are they maybe not the real deal, or is Zenergy just that good? What does this say to you guys?
It should be noted there was a DQ loss for the Dream Team. Yama Killer in the fourth spot had a DQ loss against Aeroid, but even so, it's pretty unprecedented for your 1 seed and your 3 seed to get 3-0'd. Your 2 seed get beat 3-2 and losing 3-1 in the 5 seed as well. I don't know. This, the Dream Team was doing pretty well. They took a bad beating, and I definitely think it reflects on both teams. We don't see this too much, and the teams that have been doing this, I don't think this is the first time this season that Synergy's even gotten 20 points. So, yeah. I don't know. I'd say it reflects about as you would expect on both teams.
Yeah, I mean, given the spectrum of how well Zenergy did, or rather the Dream Team. No, Zenergy did versus
the Dream Team.
I don't know, man. They're just... I'm scared of Zenergy. That's all I can say. That's all I can say.
You don't have to play him.
I know, man.
So, here's a matchup that bothers me this week, as I try to figure out what to do with making sense of it. Avatar, who... I made a case defending as why they should have been considerably higher in the power rankings, holding the most amount of points. They come up against team maybe we'll try Storm. and granted, there's a DQ in the 5 spot.
Oh, yeah. We'll get to that PSA later.
There seems to be... I don't know. They had a shot. They had a 2-3 loss in the 1 seed. They had two of their other guys win. Actually, the DQ is what sealed the victory for
yes.
Archon Storm.
Yes.
So
could have gone either way.
You know
that
what?
Feel good.
Can we actually learn anything from this? I already know your answer, Slim. But I'll still give you the chance to say it anyways, because I know how you feel about it.
I mean, we saw Verde and Clark Kent in the top 10 players this week. I think it's deserved for Verde, even though he'll argue that it's not. And I don't know. They've had four-in-one runs this season. So with that and, you know, Hertz Donut, it's not doing too badly. I think Killjev's kind of having a somewhat rough season. But I don't know. I think this measures up nicely for Archon Storm and kind of puts a slowdown on Team Avatar and we'll stop some bragging in Discord. Apparently they changed their 5 seed now, by the way.
Yeah, I was just going to say, learning from chat, they have a new 5 seed. Which, you know what? It's the captain's right if you get DQ'd. I don't know if that's the case. I have no clue. But just let you know, if you get DQ'd on my team, bye.
Yeah.
Nate, do you see it any differently? Or are you kind of... What are your thoughts?
I don't know, Archon Storm, despite whether you say you're on vacation or if, you know, anyone's trying to argue they're not comfortable with the new meta or the new expansion, whatever, it's, you got good guys who know how to play the game, you know, so mm-hmm. it's not a surprise to see them win against a strong team, so I don't know. I think they're as good as any of these other top teams.
Yeah.
So next up on the docket, Netherstorm takes on Noob Central. Feels entropy.
I thought we were going to skip over this.
Feels entropy, man. Yeah, it feels very entropy, man. Third Seed Blue gets a sneaky win off of Tide Second Orange. Nade, you were there. What happened?
Yeah, so, you know, hey, I mean, congrats to Netherstorm. You know, they did very, very well against us. You know, close match between Stiller and Sir Spamzalot. You know, Stiller broke down the whole series to me, and you know, I heard when it went down. So I was happy to hear that he got two wins because apparently Spam brought some cool decks, played well. So, you know, he deserved that win.
Cool
you know,
decks, Kappa Keeper.
Yeah, with his well, I'm not gonna strategy out there, but
oh yeah, for sure.
You know, but given that match, I put Twiz on the same decks, and was able to prepare pretty well. I mean, I know there was a lot of questions of Bog Creeper and Baron Geddon and like Senjin and Temple Warrior, which are all terrible decisions. But
hey, the Baron Geddon worked. He paved the way for his master, the Fire Lord. So.
Did we submit that to Trollden, by the way?
I did.
I think he did, yeah. Yeah, man. I had Varian Wrynn and a Grom Activator, and he was at 9 health. So I was like, do I risk playing the Wrynn and not being able to activate the Grom, and then Reno comes out next turn, or Twisting Nether, or whatever it was? So it was like, I was so torn. And then I said, fuck it, just, you know, drop in, you know, the armies of Stormwind, so they came through. But, yeah, I felt pretty confident going up against Twiz, feeling like I can guess what decks that he was bringing. And really, I was targeting Rogue. That's why I was putting a lot more taunts in my Temple Warrior. You know, so we took that win. Cutthroat got 3-0'd. Nothing new there this season. Let's see. Josh Sampson got 1-3'd by Super Explosive Sheep. You know, he's a good player, you know. So props to him for taking out Samson. And, you know, Hamboning came into, you know, an incident that happened, you know, right before his match. We had to take care of his son. Couldn't get on in time to play. So, you know, DQ happened. So we're struggling this week. We're hoping to bounce back next week, though. We don't have an easy opponent. So who knows what will happen.
Anything can happen.
Anything
can happen.
Yeah, it was a pretty rough week. I'm trying to load up the standings. Yeah, dropped you down to 4th in the standings of the orange, and
yeah,
the damage ones and the superheroes are in the way. So, yeah, that's definitely important to climb back up there, because the wild card spots, with you guys going up against blue, it's hard to get those.
I mean, it's okay. You get tons of points against Team Rank 5 this week. You're fine.
One will hope so. I mean, it'll probably be an even match.
Moving towards your buddies there at Team Rank 5, they took on Supreme this week, and Team Rank 5 gets the win, 16-10. I don't know what to say about this one, man. It's pretty convincing. In the 3-5 spots, as I would say you would expect it to be, except for the fact that Dear Jason sits in the 3 seed. Moxie returns in prime form and decides that he wants a 3-0 victory.
On Salty Saturday, of all.
What a series that was.
Jesus C proves that he's better. Jesus C proves he's better than Bende!
Bende! Yeah. This I thought for Imbolc and Parker to lose to their opponents, you know, Cheesy and Racy, definitely feels kind of bad. I think they definitely could have won. I think the 2-3 implies that. And honestly, to do 2-3 against those guys, they are probably used to beating their opponents much worse than that. So yeah, pretty pretty good look for Team Rank 5 over there.
Yeah, and that's kind of what Team Rank 5 brings to the table is if you're one of those teams that comes in with the overpowered 2 seed or the overpowered 3 seed, you're not getting away with that with Team Rank 5 because they got guys that can come right back at you. And I would even start to argue, because he has yet to prove it wrong, that my MVP, Jesus C., is doing a pretty damn good job holding down that 4 spot for Team Rank 5 this season.
He's doing great.
So, you know, even those OPOP 4 seeds have themselves a challenge when it comes to Team Rank 5. Just make you feel super good about next week, Nate. Just letting you know.
So excited to play Imbolc. Haven't beat him yet.
I had to edit the inside voice that said, and you're not going to. Oh, shit. It came out anyways.
Oh, no. You just said it.
But definitely a fun matchup to watch play out as these two Titans went at it. And even where Supreme won, Team Rank 5, as Slim said, clawed their way to – their losses were two win losses. And their victories were very decisive, 3-0 or 3-1. Very strong showing from Team Rank Fraud. Congrats, guys. All right. Yeah,
definitely one we're gonna be talking about. I mean, it's gonna be pretty interesting. The season's still relatively young. We're about halfway through. I wouldn't be surprised if we see these two teams again in playoffs. So.
Oh yeah.
Cool stuff.
Yeah, for sure. Speaking of moving forward in the season, a couple of matches we wanted to throw up there. The thing you guys have to understand about the Red Division is that. It's been close all season long, and we're starting to see some degree of separation. Those 5-point differences from ranks 1 to 4 are kind of gone, and there's some teams that were very much so in the hunt that are now trying to claw their way back in. One of those teams that really needs to kind of make sure to dig their heels in and not get pushed any further is the Dream Team. And they have to go up against Archon Storm this week, who is proven to be a pretty reliable team this season. How do you guys see this one playing out?
One sec. There was just an email that distracted me there. So the Dream Team has a good opportunity here to bounce back. They're going as fourth up against second. I don't really see Archon Storm letting up too much from what they did last week. Although, I mean, I'm looking at Pink Samus there in the 3 spot. I'm looking at Hertz Donut, who we've all known up to this point. Maybe he's not trying that much, but I don't know. I believe in the Hertz, my fellow undefeated player in season one. Yep. So I don't know. Ultimately, I end up favoring Archon Storm here, but... And that would go a really long way to solidifying their spot in the playoffs moving forward, because I'm not actually sure how many red teams they have left to face. There's definitely one or two.
Yeah, I think there's two. Don't quote me on that.
Don't mind me. I'm just going to write a hey guys to fat, dumb, stupid idiot here.
I'm right here, man. You don't have to write anything.
Oh, hi, Jackson.
Aw, thanks, Lush. Yeah, I think this is a tough challenge for the Dream Team. I think Archon Storm can really kind of put the Red Division, not I won't say behind them because there's still a few weeks left, but really get themselves in a good spot to know that they got the playoffs coming and put the Dream Team away for the season. So I also favor them in the matchup overall, as I think as you go up seed from seed, I think they match up very well against the Dream Team. The only spots that I expected to be a battle is Arbitrary Armor and Verde. Arbitrary is shown to be a pretty good competitor throughout. And Pink Samus, if I don't know. I keep waiting for Pink Samus to be this player that I've heard that he/she, I'm not sure. Is, but Hertz is a challenge for anyone. And Yama Killer could potentially sneak one off of Killer Jive, who's having a tough season. But I also know Killer Jive's a real good Hearthstone player and has the potential to win against anybody down there in that 4 spot.
Yeah, Killer Jive's often been talked about as one of the more, you know, like high value buys, if you will, as a player in terms of his PR.
Hmm. Yeah, and I like Archons. Acorn. I like Acorn's classes better in these matchups that are posted so far. There's still some more people who got to submit classes. That's counting down, guys, hour out. But I give it to Archon.
So go ahead and mess it up, Archon. Prove us all wrong. This is a sweet matchup coming up next year as Zinergy takes on NWA. I feel like this is the Supreme Team Rank 5 matchup that we saw last week, but in the green-red divisions. This is going to be sweet, man. That's really all I'm going to say about it because I couldn't pick a winner
there's some results already.
Yeah, but you know what?
Yeah.
You got a pre-even matchup in Salt against Boom Boom Hall. I tip my hat to Red Marsh. I tip my hat to... Actually, Crayon might be the guy that gives Arroy a challenge, but I still think Arroy puts him away.
This fat, dumb stupidity, it's making me laugh.
I don't know. Overall, so yeah, here's why I say this, Slim. Just because, yes, the results in currently favor NWA, but I don't see a match that goes heavily in favor of NWA the rest of the way. It's either a coin flip or favors Zinergy as you move out. And the 4-0 definitely helps NWA. You know, that's a huge way to start it. But if the rest of the matches, even if they go 3-2, it's not going to be enough. True.
I mean, it looks like a PR deficit for Crayon in the 4th seed against Aroy, and I definitely think Aroy has been quite good, but actually this is probably like the strongest 4th seed head-to-head in the entire league, and that might just like speak to the strengths of these teams, is that they're so powerful in that seed. It's a good seed to have a player like this in. So
Aroy says he's losing anyway, so...
I mean, I'm rooting for my opponent, hashtag man crush. I mean, I would root for... I'd put money on Crayon if we could do betting a lot of the time.
What's that damn betting site? I already messed up. FanDuel. We're going to have THL FanDuel, guys. It's coming.
Yes. Oh, my God. Let me spend more money on stuff No, well, hey, I mean, you guys know Salt is my boy.
God.
Oh, is there a result in?
Oh, no. Sorry. Go.
Salt's my boy. You know, I'm co-hosting a show with him. You know, he and I have been hanging out for a while. So I give this one to Zinergy.
So you take the same philosophy as me. Salt, yeah. I love you. Can't wait to watch you lose.
Love you, Salt.
The casuals. You casuals over there. You know what I don't like about you, Slim? Let me talk about why I'm mad at the Manlift. All right. Once upon a time, there were two hosts on this show that were dead last in their division with no hopes of ever getting division. Then there was one asshole of a host who was on one of the best teams in the league.
I mean, one of the best teams.
And then this Manlift of an asshole, this asshole of a Manlift, has to go ahead and get his team to 3 in the green division. So I'm the only sad fuck sitting over here losing all the time. Not only that, but like I'm so bad, I got kicked off of my own team, my captain. So figure that one out, THL. Anyways, the Ghost of Casuals are playing Pure Strategy this week. Now I'm cheering for Pure Strategy.
Well then, all right. Sorry, I'm trying to do things with this. I have Salt Saturday to
Trump Alex Straza 2016.
Yeah, so Alex Straza bought completely horrible classes this week, and frankly, I'm quite insulted. He brought Druid, Hunter, Paladin, and Rogue. Like, there's no Shaman, Warlock, or Warrior in there. I don't know what's going on. But we're going to have a good time on Team Rank Friday, spoiler alert. Yeah, I don't know. I threw this one in here because there are definitely standings implications here. If the Ghost of Casuals were to win, which obviously I want, but I'm not going to try and talk about that too much on Tavern Talk, is that it would put a lot of displacement in the green division. Pure Strategy would go down, down, down. Ghost of Casuals go up, up, up. Maybe solidify as a 3 spot, which can get a spot into the playoffs. But as it stands, Red is still pretty homogenous over there. So it's difficult, but it's a very... interesting matchup in a division that a lot of people aren't giving the time of day. So you'll get to see a little bit of it on Team Rank 5. So look forward to that.
Yeah, whatever the mainland said. That's a thing.
Yeah, and I would give an opinion, but I don't really care about this matchup.
I mean, you really have no reason to.
Supreme takes on the damaged ones. This is a pretty good matchup. This one actually, Nate, is pretty important for you guys.
Yeah, man.
As Supreme's sitting number two blue, and the damaged ones are sitting number two orange. On paper, this one looks pretty heavily favored for the damaged ones. No, I'm just kidding. for Team Supreme.
So bad.
There's already a result in as Bites does his best, but Ray C does get away with the 3-2 victory. I'm starting to wonder, you know what, I'm not even going to say this on air because I don't want to put Ray C's business out there, but I'm wondering if there's a reason these are all going 3-2. So, I don't know, guys. You look at it, do you think with the result already coming in that top three as a win, do you think Rex could get a win off of Dear Jason? Do you think Soul can stand up to Cheesy? I was under the impression when the season started that Soul was a pretty big deal.
Sure, he can be. You know, we all know the deal that Cheesy is as well. I mean, I can't speak much to that matchup, but I can speak to Rex, and that's what I'll say. I mean, we saw Dear Jason struggle last week. I don't know if he really struggled. I just don't think he had the cards. But one thing I could say about Rec is he puts his 24/7 into THL, man. When he subbed for us 1 week, all he did was just prep, practice, deck build, adjust, practice, deck build, adjust. Like, he knows what he's doing, and he preps better than anybody else. And he'll even hit me up while he's on, you know, his team this season and ask me for advice, suggestions, practice. So he's putting in the work. I don't think it's going to be a sweep. I wouldn't be surprised if this could go 2-3 either way with Rex, but that's all I'm going to say.
I think this one's interesting because the damaged ones are in a spot in their division where they're not very solidified. Team Rank 5 beat Supreme. I believe the superheroes also beat Supreme. Correct me if I'm wrong. I believe that happened this season. So I think there's like kind of pressure on teams like the damaged ones. If you want to be in the top of orange, this is a team that you have to beat. I think they'll do pretty well against them, but overall I'd favor Supreme quite a bit. I think they could probably take one match off one of the top three. Not sure who that is. Or at the very least it'll be pretty close. And then I definitely think that they'll win one in the four or the five spot. I'm not sure what. I know Jerry hasn't had the most incredible season, but and Sneaky Hero, like, despite the 100 PR that you see there, he started out, like, well below that. This is a minimum that we have. So Sneaky Hero has been doing a pretty fine job, actually. So I think the damaged ones are going to really look to Takua to take out Bednay!
Bednay!
So, yeah. It's an uphill battle. If Jerry can take out Sneaky Hero, like, if they can do that 4-5 punch, which is, like, definitely the avenue to beating Supreme, I think, is what we've seen. Then maybe they can, but I don't know. I believe quite a bit in Supreme. It's a tough opponent for the damaged ones, but
yeah, so we'll have to see. Another match of probably great interest to you, Nate, because you got back-to-back tough matchups for the two teams ahead of you in the Orange Division. Yeah. Netherstorm takes on the Superheroes. And this one is, I'm looking it over right now. I'm super interested in it. Sir Spamslot just came off of a pretty big win last week, in being Stiller, who is a well-respected player if you've been following THL for a while now. I believe it was Cassie who even said on this show that beating Noob Central without Stiller, is not truly beating Noob Central.
I'm surprised to see him lose.
Yeah, so Sir Spamslot takes on a beast in Cracksmas, but if you could stand up to Stiller, you got a shot with most people in this league. I always say Boca and I. Wow, I don't know how I just spit that out. He's taking on Twiz. So two matches that PR-wise seem very heavily favored for the superheroes, I could not write off as surefire wins. As Twiz was on Entropy, and I've watched Twiz within this league, very solid player, been multi-legend, great Hearthstone mind, could beat any player on any day. Yeah. I can't really write those off as surefire wins, although I do think they tip the scales in the superhero's favor there. MLG Anakin's not going to submit classes, so Kroven wins that.
Get in there, man. Get in there. Come on.
I'm spamming the chat. Classes, but they're not here, obviously.
Krona. So pretty much here's how it goes. Is 1 and 2 favor superheroes. 4 and 5 not only favor Netherstorm, but the 5 seed for Netherstorm, Gemini, already has a 3-1 result in.
Rock on, Gem.
So.
I favor Krovan for Netherstorm. That's just me, though. And I would give either Twiz or Sir Spam's Law. I'd give one of them a win. So even not looking at Gemini, I also think the Super Explosive Sheep is really strong as a 4 seed too. He's really active.
Mm-hmm. So do you think this is the week, Nate, that you guys get to jump up a bit? Playing Team Rank 5, an easy opponent for you?
Not an easy opponent for us. Before when I said it might be an even match, that's just me trying to pick the spirits up of my team. Now, superheroes against Netherstorm, damaged ones against Supreme. Like, I feel like superheroes are the stronger team, despite the result that's in, despite Darby getting, if he gets those classes in and plays a game, I think they have a shot.
It would help.
Damaged ones, I'll always put Supreme over anybody, but just for fuck's sake, I want to put damaged ones on top here because why not? So that just makes it that much harder for us. So, I'm excited to see how this turns out as well. But
you know, I'm going to do a good guy thing real quick because Twiz is my buddy. News literally just in from the Facebook group for THL. Sir Spamslot just found out. Literally like moments ago that he's going to be unable to play this week. Classes are submitted, but Netherstorm does need a 1-seed sub with 472 or less, and you do have to play with Sir Spamslot's classes of Mage, Shaman, Warlock, and Warrior. Oh, no, sorry, that was last week.
No, that's this week.
Okay, so.
That's same as this week.
Pretty good classes.
Yeah.
So if you're an SPL person, you're eligible for this. If you're a free agent, you're eligible for this. Or if you're me, you're eligible for this. Fucking let's go, Cracksmiths.
Where's Necro this. Havoc? Like, don't you want to secure a win in the one seat? Get Necro.
He did take down Cheesy.
He is THL's official substitute. So get in the Necro. All right. Slims, why don't you tell the folks about this next thing?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to spam this in the chat until I get globally banned. Here we go. So this is the... I failed.
All the hype to be followed
so
by
that. I've been hyping up this live meta report thing for a good week or two now. I love it. They've decided to collaborate with... actually, Ray C, who's on Team Supreme, is a member of an actual professional Hearthstone team, Team Vicious Syndicate. A lot of other people on that team. You might know Demigod, for example. Very frequent, not even top 100 finisher, but like top 10, top 20 legend finisher. So this is a website that they've kind of taken a week's worth of data that like thousands of different, well, it's like hundreds, but there's thousands of games in there.
27,000 games.
Yeah, by players just like me, by anyone, that just they submit their ladder games. A bunch of data gets collected, and they use all of this to form kind of a meta report of what's out there on ladder. Archetypes are figured out as well, and they did something new this week where they made like a power ranking, kind of like what the meta snapshot that Tempo Storm has, although this one's based off of frequency of the classes and the archetypes and their win rates. Mm-hmm. So you can put a lot of weight in this, and I really look forward to following this every week, and of course submitting data, which you can do by downloading TrackBot and following the pretty easy instructions on this thing. So yeah, I just thought this was the coolest thing, and it got me excited for a bit before I had to become socio-normative again.
Yeah, I mean, if you're one of those players who likes to do research on your opponent, who likes to try and guess what is my opponent going to bring, and who likes to try to prepare how can I best beat this person, cutthroat, use this because it could really help your performance in THL. It's a good tool.
It's data is king. And here's just some more for, you know, I'm going to throw up on our stream here. It's not quite as in depth, but I still greatly appreciate the effort. Fisama gave us a, it's not broken down to archetypes, but it's a 1-5, weeks 1-5 overall view. I'll leave it up here for the rest of the show for those of you who want to geek out over it. To a class, how often it's been brought throughout the 5 weeks, and its tendency to get banned. So it's pretty much the graphics we've been showing you compiled all into once. I don't know if he was inspired by this Vicious Syndicate thing or whatever, but...
they're working to get... Oh, no, wait, never mind.
Nah, he made it himself.
I definitely appreciate his efforts, and if you are somebody that's a data-crunching dude or a number-crunching dude and you want to see if you can help him out, reach out to him. I don't know if he needs your help or not, but these graphics get me a little tingly inside. So,
yeah, it's a good thing I said at the desk. Let's just say that.
Oh, wow, the third leg there. All right, so this weekend we have... I love when we get to Tavern Talk and I look at Team Rank Friday and Salty Saturday, and we already have a vast majority of it filled out. Make it his triumphant return to Team Rank Friday is the Manlet himself taking on Donald Trump's vice presidential candidate, Alex Graza.
AKA New Ability.
Right. What is that?
7 p.m. on Team Rank Friday. Followed thereafter by another awesome match. Wow, these are actually some sick matches on Team Rank Friday.
Oh, yeah.
Aroy takes on Crayon. I am actually happy I don't have plans for tomorrow because I'm going to be sitting here with a beer watching some Team Rank Friday. I will miss Cassidy's Helen Keller comments, but I don't know if he's going to phone in on that one because I'm pretty sure he could do voice. Salty Saturday is going to be kicking off with Dunamis versus Pumbaa's BFF at standard starting time, followed by Andy Rogers versus Dot Dark. That's actually, have we seen Dot Dark yet?
No,
I haven't. Queen Andy taking on Dot Dark. That's going to be a good one, too. And then
Queen himself.
Arcane Fu. Arcane Fu. That's his old name. Arcane THL now will be taking on Follow Durden. And
those be are actually two matches from one series between the Harry Generals and Aeon. So yeah, Aeon looks for its. I'm gonna check Team Reek 5 here. They look for their first win against the Harry Generals. That's DiTrucci's old team.
I would just like to say that I'm the only person in the preseason rankings that didn't have Aeon stupidly high. Just gonna throw that out there.
Nice job, Jack Sox.
It hurts to come good. Back. And the Sunday ticket is currently open and available, but you guys know how that goes. Throw it up in the Facebook. MB Parker and Brunson will stream you and rip you apart, and it'll be a good time for all involved except you. So volunteer for that. It's a good time. All right, Q&A time. I want to kick this one off with I read this question, and I pogchamped, and... It was fucking... I love this question. I don't know why. It's a
PogChamp status.
Yeah. So our very own Casty asked... he says he's seen recent hypothetical talk of Hearthstone Hall of Fame after this continued... I'm losing my thoughts here. If THL opened a Hall of Fame... There we go. If THL opened a Hall of Fame like other leagues and allowed 5 introductory members, who would they be and why? Does your Hall of Fame only look at performance, or does it look at contributions as a whole, like some other halls? I love this question. I will defer to you guys first.
Sure. Here's what I'll say about this, because I always like to compare things like this to stuff that already exists. So it's like you look at the NFL Hall of Fame, right? Like, you know, for example, to be nominated for that, you have to be retired for 5 years. We can't do that here, right? So maybe you can do something like you've been in THL for like 4 or 5 seasons. You've had a level of success as a player, right? And contributed to something to the greater good of the community. Like, if I'm rating based off of that, I think you could start placing people into like Hall of Fame spots. So if I were to pick 5, you know, you're going to start with Jedi and Necro for a million obvious reasons. Like, they without them, there's nothing, right? I would put these two guys above me up in there just because of, you know, their history with the league and everything that they've done. A lot of people look up to you guys, love what you guys do, and you've had your levels of success within the league. Maybe not Jack Sox, but and then, you know, I think the fifth one is pretty obvious. It's Donnie Wrench, just because of everything he does for the community. Kappa, big old Kappa. You can spam the chat with Kappa right now. So that would be my 5 right there. And the other thing that the NFL does is talk about, like, how much does a player represent the core values of the NFL organization, right? So it's like we have our own core values too. So you can kind of look at, like, are players living up to what we're asking them to do, whether it's being, you know, a good team player, contributing to the community, X, Y, and Z. So I think this could be something. I love this question, but Slim, I'd love to hear your opinion.
Ooh, yeah, I would also value not only performances, but also just contributions as a whole. It would just feel wrong if Jedi Ninja was not in this.
Yeah, they're
so
one and two,
that,
right?
So that has to be, and also I would put Necro Havoc, because we see his posters all the time, but little known, he's doing a million things behind the scenes as well. I would have a hard time not placing players who became MVPs for a season in the Hall of Fame.
I like that.
So I think those get filled in automatically, and I'd be one of them. Like, for an MVP not to be in the Hall of Fame, it just seems wrong. But I don't know about that, because that might exclude a lot of other players and individuals who also have not only the performance that it takes to be an MVP, but contributions as a whole, of which there are many. And I mean, we see it all the time now. There's a lot of people doing different things in THL that mean quite a bit. It's definitely a lot about the league play and what goes on in the league, but
yeah. You know, I'm going to take it a little different direction from you guys. I don't put this akin to the NFL. I put it in, don't laugh at this, hear this out. I actually put this more in the wrestling Hall of Fame category. Because commentators, hype men, various different personalities, as well as the wrestlers themselves, get thrown in there. And I think that's kind of what I would look at in the THL Hall of Fame, because there's a couple names that weren't thrown out there that I would consider / include. I can think of 5 players off the top of my head, like nothing. 5, you know, the 3 MVPs, as long as they met. I like the idea of there being a requirement. You've had to have been in the league for at least, I would say, somewhere between 3 or 4 seasons. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how much we value the development years, but I think that those contributions, even if they only played Alpha, Beta, Kappa, but did not play Season 1, because Season 1 wouldn't have happened without Alpha, Beta, Kappa. But I definitely think we started off, I would never disagree with Jedi the Godfather and Necro Havoc, the man that he's, if Jedi's the captain of the ship, Necro is the glue. I'm not going to say nails. He's the fucking glue that holds this ship together, because he's everywhere doing every job. He's keeping the sails together. He's keeping the water sealed out. He's the fucking man behind the scenes, for those of you who don't know. I definitely think that we could put Slimsh in there, not just because he's an MVP, but because he's been a Tavern Talk host this whole time and a captain. He fills so many roles that an exemplary member of the community and trying to like show what it's about. But one name you guys left out that it would be a coin flip in my head, but I'm gonna go with him because he's the original. What about like for two seasons, you turn on Salty Saturday, who are you greeted by?
Faraday.
You know? So
the face of THL.
He's our emotes. Yeah, definitely. He's been a great player. I think he's somebody that even if you don't think his play warranted it, which he'd be the first person to say it doesn't, I think giving up your Saturday nights for 2.5 seasons straight is a pretty damn Hall of Fame worthy thing. And then last but not least, I would give it to a captain. Eric and Jedi would have to be first ballot Hall of Famers just because of all they do. Then there'd be a player, a captain, a personality. Verdae being the personality, Slim Shady player. I would say Mange as a captain. And,
I like it.
You know, so I would have to look at it as full spectrum. I don't know if that's how every Hall of Fame induction would go or how it would split up. There'd probably be more players as you went on and less personalities. But I think for the first five, that would be what I'd look at. So awesome question. You know what I'd actually like to see get done? And if somebody in chat could do this because I'm feeling really lazy right now, I'd like to see in the Facebook group just kind of like start a thread like we did with our dream team, your five-member dream team staying underneath the PR cap. Let's get a thread going because I'd just like to know what everybody would put in for that.
Got you.
So moving on to the next question while Slim gets that set up for us. Awesome that we have Nate here to kind of help us with this one. The Grim Gamer wants to know, will there be a team after the salt settles versus Team Tavern Talk Showdown?
This is a classic Grim question. I mean, Slimsh already emailed Grim. me and confirmed that he's going to play a best of five Yogg Only's deck match with me, so you'll have that. Some of that may or may not have been true, what I just said. But.
So here's the real question that I'm going to answer his question with a question. Does that question really need to be asked?
It'll happen.
It's going to happen.
We'll do it in the Blackrock Brawl.
Yeah, it'll be in an off season. It'll be one of our off season events.
Oh, Jax, I see what Salt's saying about you in chat.
Let's see what we got.
It should be every.
Okay. No, the other one.
Oh, you beat the shit out of Jack Sox. It depends on how many beers you had, Salt. I'd give you a 30 rack and walk away for a little bit and then come back and fight you. So I think that'll happen for sure. Is this a PSA or am I supposed to read Slim Shop confused?
It's a question that inspired me to have us do a PSA as an answer.
Got you.
Or just whatever you may want.
Yeah, so Smoke Salmon asks, or not asks, more states. Last week there were around 10 matches that didn't get played. Do you think this was just a bad week or could it be an issue that needs to be addressed?
Always a combination of both, right? Like, we haven't had this issue to address in THL in a while, right? Like, every week you might see one, you might see two, you might see none.
Not since last.
We have seen a lot. So, yeah, I mean, communicate with your team, guys. Like, if you know you can't make it, if you think you can't make it, it's better to get a substitute in there. Even if it's just comes down to scheduling issues, like there was a week or two ago, like we had class submissions, but we just couldn't schedule. And rather than both guys taking 0-0 or somebody getting 0-3, like we just brought somebody in the sub to make a match happen. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just communicate with your captains about this. And captains, if you think something is fishy going on with a teammate who's not communicating as much, you know, like reach out to them, ask them what's up, because we want to see matches being played. Like nobody enjoys getting that 3-0 DQ. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I had a DQ win myself this season, and I wasn't happy about it at all. I've never have been ever since I started subbing in Season Alpha when it was rampant back then. People got DQ'd all the time, and I never got to play matches subbing in then. So Yeah, I think this is just a player by player, captain by captain issue. So if it's happening, captains, find out what's up with your player. If you read the rules, captains do have the power. If your player is a frequent person who's not getting their matches scheduled, they're getting a bunch of DQs, they just don't take responsibility, you have the ability to make a mid-season roster change. You can take that person out and put someone in who's going to be playing their matches a little bit better. So maybe it's just a bad week. I think it, when these things happen, teams definitely learn about them. And yeah, substitutions are always an option, but sometimes it's not so easy to land a sub, although I think now there's a bigger pool than ever. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I was just going to say that. I'll lead off with that because you finished on that thought there. There's 108 people right now that want to be on a team. If your guy doesn't want to be, there you go. Problem solved. The other piece of that, and I'm going to toot my own horn here because it's one of the few things I can be proud of within the THL because damn sure isn't my record.
Never a DQ?
Never a DQ for myself or my team from Kappa on.
I've had two.
And I think part of the reason for this is as a captain, I don't allow players on my team that refuse to communicate. We have a Google Hangout. We have a Skype chat. We have tons of people with busy schedules, but you know what they tell us? I have a busy fucking schedule. But they check in with us at least once a day. You know, if your team's not communicating, that's on you, Captain. If somebody's not communicating with you, fix it, or there's 180 people looking for a team. I've always said personality comes before all else when building my team, and that's why we're dead last right now. So, good to bring it up. Get those. Listen, even if you have to get somebody like me as a sub in your one seed, it's still better to have a shot than have that guaranteed 4-0 loss.
Oh, definitely.
You know.
Yeah, take Jack Sox.
Because DQs also weigh negatively on you as a captain, and if it becomes a frequent thing, like we as a THL board are going to look at it, and we're going to come to you and like expect you to act. Because DQs really are bad. Like, the number thing we want are people to play their matches. That's the whole point of the league, is to give
people... play Hearthstone.
Give people an opportunity to have this league where they get to play, you know, best of five conquest matches, which otherwise a lot of us wouldn't be.
Slimsh, I got to go off on a tangent right now. To Slimsh's point right there, the whole point of this league is to fucking play Hearthstone.
Here's Warcraft.
And I'm going to call out...
Here's a knife chuckler.
Yo, so... A lot of times people email me and say, hey, shit went wrong. Here's our proposed solution. I know it's a little bit of work on your side, but can you help us out here so we can get this match played? Stop being fucking win-hungry pussies. Play your match. I fucking hate people that are thirsty for the DQs. We're here to play Hearthstone. Play fucking Hearthstone. Stop fishing for the DQs. If you have to move the time an hour to play and you are capable of doing that, fucking make it work. I'm sorry, but like it annoys me to no end when I see an email thread where, hey, can we play at 1 o'clock? Sure, let's play at 1 o'clock. Guy gets an email at 12:15. Hey, I've got a flat tire. I'm on the side of the road. Can we push it back to 2:30? Nah, man, I got shit to do. What's your shit to do? That, I mean, if you have real plans, fine. But you got the rest of the weekend to figure it out. Dude had legit reason. Stop being thirsty for fucking 4-0 DQ victories. It doesn't make you look good. Sorry. Play the fucking game of Hearthstone. Now, if you do have... Hey, I understand. There's been tons of weaknesses this happened to me. I'm leaving Saturday morning at 11 o'clock. I won't be home the rest of the weekend. If we can't get it in at 10 o'clock, that's it. I'm sorry, I'm just not here. That's fine, guys. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking about the guys who are not willing to push their plans to go get shit-faced at the bar back half an hour to get this shit done. Stop being thirsty for DQs. Earn your wins. Be a respectable human being. Fuck. There, I'm done. anyways, thank you, Smoke Salmon, for bringing that to our attention.
Thanks, Smoke Salmon.
So, Jerry asks... Jerry Cook. So looking through the past seasons, it looks like the last season champs had a PR of 1957 at the end of the season. Xenergy already has 1918 halfway through the season. Do you think they could break the record of going over 1957 by the end of the season? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think they can, and they will.
Sorry, that was not a more exciting answer.
We still love you.
Guys, yeah. I put that question there. I just thought it was interesting that someone was paying so close of attention to the league that, like, we're getting here now where the we're seeing how high they go at the end, like how much they just won. Because I'm pretty sure Zenergy started, didn't they start right on the money in terms of PR cap? Didn't they start right at 1800?
Grim, you're fucking drunk. Count Wicked Wednesday. I whipped the shit out of you. I'm ahead in the series 4-2. Get over yourself. Sorry.
Jeez.
Apologies. I'm a little yeah. Anyways. Grim, I love you. I would call on the community again, because, you know, Slips, you bring up a good point of it's cool that somebody paid attention to this. I would find it interesting to see, like, highest single player score throughout a season, highest team PR throughout a season, highest overall team score through a season. And just to have these stats, they're pointless. But you know what? So is the Guinness Book of World Records. Look how many fucking copies that sells every year. You know? So if you have nothing better to do with your time and you feel like compiling that, I will look it over and then immediately disregard it, but be happy that you did it. So if anybody feels like doing that, that'd be cool. God, I'm bullying a 17-year-old. God, I'm such an asshole.
Good for you, man. Good for you.
That's I got to pick on somebody. Because Lord not? Knows I can't beat you in Hearthstone. So I got to beat you somehow. All right, so...
Jackson, everyone in this chat is calling you out. They want to fight you.
Dude, I'll fight everybody.
Fat, dumb, stupid idiot is like 1v1 me, mate.
Jack Sox, can we get our SBL match streamed?
Yeah, I'm down for that.
If people want to see Jack Sox get beat down, let's get our match streamed.
Hey, guys, if you want to see me do exactly what I've been doing all season long and get fucking stomped in Hearthstone, Nate and I will try to get our SPL match streamed. And I'd be more than happy to do that. And you know what? I'll tell you what, Nate, I'll even try against you.
Ooh, I won't, but that's awesome. Good for you.
It's only fair you handicap yourself, right?
Yeah.
One arm behind your back.
I don't know how I can handicap myself enough, but we'll try.
Fuck.
This hurts, never man. Lucky.
This hurts. Never lucky, rubber ducky. All right. So I just want to – all right, let me put it this way, Ray. A hunter burgled a gore howl from me. Figure that fucking one out. Yeah. Yeah, I said burgled. All right, Michael Chan. Who the fuck is – oh, Brunson. The shitter Brunson wants to know, is Tavern Talk in jeopardy of being replaced by THL in 60 seconds?
Oh, yes.
What is the future of recaps? Are we going to have a daily recap shit post?
I already emailed Jedi. I was like, cancel our show, cancel Tavern Talk, because THL in 60 seconds is here. That's all we need. That's all we want. I think it's in huge jeopardy, man.
So maybe the real question should be, is after the Salt Cell is going to have a show match with THL in 60 seconds? Because apparently Tavern Talk's already dead. I'm going to go get the rope.
I've already got the process of collecting my unemployment.
Actually, that happened.
Yeah.
Slimsh did ask me for all of his tax information so that...
Yeah, I need those.
You know, though, I'm not going to lie. I laughed my ass off while fucking
listening. I liked it. I was in Discord when they were talking about it. They went in their little room and they were there for God knows how long. They had to do like 6 takes to make that thing. It was great. I enjoyed it quite a bit.
Oh, I loved every second of it.
Here's our guest speaker. Say hello, Mage. Hello. All right, now on to
keep them coming, man.
Oh, all right. So. That's it for Q&A. I think that's – do we have any PSAs this week? I forgot to check. I don't think we did other than, guys, make sure you submit classes. You have 15 minutes to get your classes in. Make sure that you're actually sending specific times in your email. Vague times do not count as an established time. You know, 1 p.m. Eastern time is a specific time. sometime Saturday afternoon is not specific. Standard shit. Please let's not have 10 DQs again this week. We haven't had that form of performance since beta. All you fucking beta cucks out there, stop it. And yeah, I think that's it. So we're going to get to parting thoughts here before I say more dumb shit. Slimsh, what would you like to tell the folks at home?
I'm going to go become legendary, I hope, tonight. I'm really looking forward to Team Rank Friday, going up against Alexstrasza / new ability. And then, of course, Salty Saturday, which I'm casting. I don't know who with at the moment. So, yeah, lots of good stuff to look forward to. Going to go in Discord, as I always do. And, yeah, just excited for another week of THL. Miss you, Cassidy.
Nade, thank you for being here.
But thank you for Nade. Sorry.
Yeah, you dick.
Yeah, right. It's like
I heard Cassie. Cassie, I miss you. Nade, you're a shitter, is what I really mean.
Nade was great.
Nade, what would you like to say for the folks at home before we part tonight?
No, thank you, Tavern Talk, for having me on your show. I really look forward to our show. You know, Monday night, 8 p.m. Eastern. Tune in. We're gonna have some more THL content for you guys. Yeah, hope you guys enjoy it. And like I said before, Brunson, I better see you there, like spamming our chat.
I'll be there. Okay. Oh, by the way, you guys have the key. You're streaming here on the Team Hearth League channel. Is that?
Yeah, correct? I got that from Jedi. So we'll be cool. on this channel.
Awesome. Well, again, thank you to Nate for filling in tonight. Thank you for Pizza for stopping by. Awesome dude. Glad we got to talk to you. Manlet, thank you for standing strong here with me tonight. And guys, tune in Monday night, 8 p.m. Listen to THL in 60 seconds, whenever the fuck they feel like putting that out. Awesome matches on Team Rank Friday tomorrow. I believe I said it starts at 8. I might be lying. Seven. It starts at 7 with Slimsh and Alexstrasza. Salty Saturday at its regular time. We will be here same bat time, same bat channel next week. And until then, bye, everybody.
Bye, fat dumb stupid idiot.
Bye.
Bye.